it on what we do and the historics. We feel that there's sufficient funding in there, which is the, obviously the information that, you know, Kevin asked us in terms of looking at impacts. But we also do have other avenues for if that capital programme money was used up and some emergencies arose, we would look at things like doing works in default. You know, they're things that we try to avoid, which is why we have the capital programme and we look at other funding sources. But there are other avenues that we would pursue to try and address some of those. And of course, we would always report back to members if it was going to be a growing emergency issue that we could see coming.
So it's been my own piece then. And Colin suggests that you may struggle to reach your partners because of the work that's happened, so you should.
Yes, we'll be able to still help everyone that we have got on our books at the moment, and we know that we can help some further people who come through the book through our systems and assessments. Obviously the money is an additionality, but at the moment where there's no pressure on the current capital programme to actually say that we would need this additional money on top.
My question's been covered. So the problem, there's only one thing hasn't. One thing happened. At the moment, and you're not mystic now. You've got more than enough money. That's it, Chair.
Perfect.
Cozy Home Scheme, as Lisa said before, it's been a programme that's been up and around for a number of years now. It's had significant impact in terms of its impact on individuals and their households. Forest schools are something new, again, very proud of that. I think Mary and her colleagues, particularly Rangers, are at the forefront of this internationally and internationally. Took it over to our sister park, Central Park, only earlier this year for them to teach their Rangers and some of the activities, and as Mary said, the impact it's had on children has been fantastic. So, Chair, just to answer your questions then. Firstly, if we talk about forest schools first and then go on to Cozy Homes. Forest schools, as Mary said, was a new concept. We didn't know what it was, we didn't know how much it cost, but we needed some money to start the pilot project up, which included staff getting trained and also buying equipment to be able to deliver the training. Mary said in year one there was an £18,000 underspend. That was actually not down to Mary or her colleagues, but there was an £18,000 underspend. As a Chief Executive Strategy Group, we looked at all of the applications both at the outset, in terms of where they fitted with the outcomes of public health, but also in terms of what we were trying to achieve as a council. And we asked a number of questions. One, were they achieved? Health outcomes, and two, with the potential to save us some money as a council in terms of public health and some of the activities that we would normally pay for. In forest schools, the answer to the first question was absolutely something support, and we didn't do it before, so there's no opportunity to substitute any mainstream funding for this. When we looked then, because of the budget situation, in terms of how we could potentially reinvest some of the public health funding that had been allocated to these schemes, we looked at each and every one. I spoke to colleagues who were responsible for both the bids and the delivery, and I agreed to a recommendation that was put to our Chief Executive Strategy Group that we reduced the forest schools by the £18,000 that had done spent year one, on the understanding that, as the various outlined, there would be no reduction in outcomes and no impact upon the services that we said we would deliver in the first part of the bid. So I was very comforted by the Forest Schools reduction. In terms of the cosy homes, again, as I said, it is something that we've been doing for a significant number of years now. And I think as Councillor Dowdy replied, bids were put into a number of available pots, one was put into the capital programmes, but one was put into the public health funds. Given its coverage, I'm not surprised the public health funds also supported the public health funds. And we also got support from the capital programme. The reduction, which again I agreed to, was based upon the fact that there was money that we also got from the capital programme fund successfully that could more than compensate for any reduction that may have been due to care having not had public health outcomes fund. So I'm comfortable, Chair, on both these projects, which as I said, I have personal pride in both of these projects. There would be no impact upon what we were trying to achieve as a council in terms of schemes.
Thank you. It's the one I asked earlier, but I thought it was better asking you rather than second. Only two. First one, the selection process was chosen by release earmarked for savings against schools. That's a question I asked. And the second one is the question that's posed by the main objective, that was ways to be capitalised.
Answers to the first one, how are these chosen? Well, I'm very happy to say these were chosen to continue, not to be stopped. Some programmes stopped, and they were outlined in the Academy called that Councillor Kelly's referred to at Delta. These were chosen to continue because of the excellent work that they did, chosen to continue as a result of what I believe were the ability to deal with reductions in the budgets. Why did I feel that? Well, I spoke to the staff, got the information, saw where we were currently in terms of the achievements, looked at what other potential sources or changes had been made, sources of funding changes had been made, and I said my recommendation to CSG was that we should absolutely continue with these projects, not stop them, but we should continue with them given our financial situation with reductions. Having said that, I think it will affect the overall outcomes that impact of our other schemes. The second question was why it hasn't been capitalised. Because there's no need to. The Cosy Homes Funds has got capital funding, the tax sale is a capital programme. As Lisa said, we believe that at this stage of the year we've got enough money to deal with what historically comes through the project in terms of requests. So we don't feel as though there was an issue to replace that money because we had the capital programme funds there to replace it already.
Would you answer the first question there, I suppose? You told me why these are stable. The question was, what was the selection process and which ones? When? So,
the selection process was everywhere. It's not part of this call, anything. Every project that was supported by Public Health Outcomes Funding was reviewed by the strategic directors and the staff delivering it. All those reviews then came back to the CSG, which we then took a view on in terms of which ones either hadn't started, were no longer valid, weren't spending the money and should stop or should carry on with a reduced amount, or indeed should, that's a significant number of issues. Carry on receiving the full amount that we need.
I think Dave's trying to take it back one step further. If you look at baseline, I think here and there is a better place to answer this question. I think what Dave is getting at, correct me if I'm wrong, is that there's no understanding of public health and free funds and the different aspects. How are decisions made to use that cost funding? Which projects were going to be picked to be funded by that? But I'm pretty sure that's one here and
there.
Yeah,
the
answer. Is that right? Have I got that right? So you're trying to get. Anybody else is that? Did you want to take them? Yeah.
Thank you. The homes, the healthy homes. I'm sure that there are plenty of homes out there that could do with our help. Whether we've got enough money for what would normally come through the door. It feels like there are more homes that we know are in need and that an extra 21 or so being helped would be a bad thing. believe there are more homes out there that need help than the ones that we would normally expect to get through our door asking for help.
Chairman, sure, the council's got right. We can only deal with what comes through to us. All of these homes are privately owned. They're private sector homes, not RSL homes. So it's down to either the individual private sector landlords or indeed the individual homeowners to come forward. And unfortunately, there are 100,000 or so homes across the world. We can't knock on every door. We can only wait for people to come forward. And as I said before, we're confident that we can deal with those that do come forward.
There are various methods we adopt when we think that people are in danger of being disadvantaged to make sure that we get council money out to those people. We act quite proactively on occasion. Presumably we're a bit less able to do that, so there's less money than we had before.
I think it's fair to say we are as proactive in this as we possibly can be. But obviously, I'm sure members wouldn't want us to be advertising it for private sector landlords, just pressing me to get the council to fund activities that they should be doing. So there's a fine balance between advertising and dealing with real issues that arise.
Yes, I've got four next, then you, Phil.
Is Kevin truly in danger of austerity measures? I'm surprised at some of the suggestions that, I mean, I can only think in simple terms of my household budget. First priority is provide shelter to the family and, you know, and invest in education. We couldn't borrow money to go a few weeks of shopping. And it seems as if to me that suggestions that we capitalise, you know, projects where there's really, as you've said, there's no need to do so, to me is a bit of a nonsense really. And so we're in a position, you perhaps might not comment on this, we're in a position where we're looking towards making savings. Last year, £27 million they were saying. So we're not in a position where we're going out there looking to spend money, looking towards, you know, spending the sparse resources that we're left with. And so it seems to me that the officers and the evidence we've heard tonight, they've been very prudent in their financial management. And despite financial pressures, they are hitting the objectives and goals they've been given. So I'm sorry, I don't want to make a political statement, but I don't think we're in a position to go by start looking for ways of spending extra money we haven't got.
And although it probably wasn't explicit, it in that report, I think it's fair to say that the proposals were a best guess at that time what the that project would cost, because many of them were limited to the funding for the as so we wanted to say there was an envelope of funding there for you to try and get that on that, and then we would monitor and evaluate that as time passed. As said by Kevin, the projects were reviewed by the contract team on a monthly basis, because the commitment was in the cabinet report that we would monitor progress and consider whether the financial values were being actually spent. And that we will, as I think this is important, we will evaluate all the projects for their impact on outcomes in May, June 2015. So we turns to some of the questions from members about whether we will continue with any of this, because I think that would be part of the result of that overall evaluation, and if it will all be considered in there in terms of any recommendations that they will put to members in the future. So it's difficult to say at this point in time how that will be.
I think in May this year, I think I've been through my experiences in active improvement. Financial commitments and making big that amount to make sure that they are being spent. So we are seeing the questions from all the projects in terms of what was being spent, just understanding what the position was at that point in time. And a number of considerations took place. First of all, was there an opportunity for the scheme to come through capital funding? And we have seen that a number of the schemes went on the evaluation were actually recognised that it was possible to do that. Were any efficiencies able to be made as a means of delivering the project that would enable it to be delivered at a lower cost? So in that first year of impact, there's been learned about how it could be delivered that actually might save some funding there. Had the project timing implementation had any impact on the spending years? We heard that one project didn't start at the beginning of the year on, so there was an understanding for a period of time. So what impact would that have on the expenditure of that year? Were there any legal commitments to be made? So we have entered into a contract with the Minister for Liaison, in which case we have to honour that to make sure we can follow through on that one. And had the interim year resulted in a reconfiguration made, which projects would be delivered? And then we've heard about the Forest Schools, where there was some reduction that said that we're in the classes of 30 as a proposal for the class. So we thought again about how those projects could be delivered. So those were a number of the key considerations, and those were brought back to us for review. And as a result, it was felt that actually the funding that we put forward could be, a number of projects would go ahead with the funding that had previously committed. A number of projects would be commissioned, say, but still delivered, and that was the basis in which we had the decisions.
Just one question on that. When you did the review, the overall review, you've seen that some have been continually forthcoming in those, some of the projects. The review outcome and evaluations, were they all on a par? Was there a large variance in the outcomes? As I said, I think what I said earlier about the children, the early years, the ability for a young child to improvement of 3 points is amazing, really is amazing. That sort of outcome benefit for the child, not in its early years, but in its life, will have a major impact on the child population. I wonder how you really relate each individual process on that sort of.
I think as I said, the full evaluation of the outcomes will happen in May, June next year. In taking this decision, the question was, what impact would we have? Could we actually afford to do it more efficiently? Wasn't the question of do we want to change the outcome that we wanted to do? It was more a question of could we be more prudent with the money that we have and potentially make that unspent amount available to spend on what we had programs elsewhere on a daily basis. I think that was the intent there. It wasn't about poor outcomes, because not all projects will have reached the point at which they're able to evaluate that again. We're all being in the cases. We've heard about some of the evidence is coming through now in terms of how many people have been seen.
So the outcomes, the review of the outcomes that are still to be finished, if they fail, then surely the minimum statement.
I've got
You don't know the answer.
Excuse me,
I responded to the
Wendy and then Anita and Jones.
Let's keep on thank you.
Thanks, Peter. So some projects have lost some money. Some projects therefore need more money. Because this public health money is public health money, isn't it? I'm wondering where it's gone. Because just in the light of what Lisa said, because I would remind members, not you to have said, he said things have to contribute to our overall needs to challenge.
Thank you. No projects were given any extra money. And in fact, we can't take a decision on reinvesting in the support of businesses.
You weren't just kind of teaming the projects, you were reviewing products.